Yes.
You said this was been doing research in Jordan and in the Arab countries, and he was one of the distinguished researchers across the world, and he is now officially nominated to the to be one of the Nobel Prize winners. Hopefully, he will get it. So I will leave it to you, leave you with him as to tell you the story, you know, as I know it's a message more than a cure. Please, Dr. Shahin.
Arab scientists. في البداية أشكر الأخ يوسف على إتاحة الفرصة لي لعرض تجربتي البحثية أمامكم. هذه التجربة وهذه القصة بتهم كل العلماء العرب الشبان أو العلماء الجدد، العلماء الذين تعلموا في أرقى الجامعات الأوروبية والأمريكية. حيث كان كل الإمكانات العلمية كل الإمكانات البحثية تحت تصرفهم انتقلوا إلى أوطانهم حيث واجهوا قلة الإمكانات واجهوا الإحباط واجهوا اليأس فتحولوا من مشاريع علمية من باحثين إلى باحثين محبطين في أوطانهم لذلك لو عملنا دراسة عن العلماء العرب اللي تخرجوا من معظم الجامعات الأمريكية والأوروبية في الدول العربية سنجد أن 90% منهم أنتج القليل بحيث يترقى ويستفيد ماديا ولكنه ليس باحث أو عالم بالمعنى الحقيقي. بيئة الإحباط بيئة خلينا نقول frustration والdisappointment والdepression موجودة في كل العالم العربي. لذلك نجد الفارق الكبير بين جامعاتنا العربية والجامعات الغربية. نجد في التصنيفات العالمية أن الجامعات العربية في ذيل الجامعات العربية في ذيل التصنيفات العالمية. العلماء العرب نجدهم بعيدين عن الجوائز العالمية، كله بسبب الشعور اللي بواجهوه في أوطانهم من إحباط، من يأس، فيتحول من باحث حقيقي إلى باحث عادي. Well, first of all, I want to thank you. I want to shed a light on the story of an Arab scientist. This scientist is me. I want to tell my story as I am a scientist, graduated from United Kingdom in 1991 and went back to Jordan to start my career there. But before that, why I should tell my story? Recently, the Center for World Class Universities at Shanghai Jiaotong and the highly cited researcher team at Thomson Reuters announced that Shah Momani has been selected to the list of highly cited researchers in 2014 and 2015. This list recognizes some of the most influential scientific minds throughout the world. Actually, less than 1% of active scientists goes to this list. So it is very high prestigious list. And according to Thomson Reuters, I was classified as one of the top 10 scientists in the world in fractional calculus. Actually, from 2009 until 2013, I was classified by researcher number one in the world in fractional calculus. In this talk, we present the story of an Arab scientist who conducted his research in the Arab universities during the past 20 years. Also, we discuss the difficulties and obstacles that faces Arab scientists and how to overcome these obstacles and produce high-quality research. But before that, let me tell you something about the highly cited researchers in the Arab world. This is the the number of highly cited researchers in 2014. It evaluates the scientists over 10 years, from 2002 and to 2012. It depends on the number of highly cited papers. Let me give you the numbers in some Arab countries and compare them with neighboring countries. I will not compare Arab countries with the Western countries because there is no comparison at all. But I will compare the Arab countries with Turkey, Iran, Malaysia, Greece. For example, Turkey has 10 scientists. Iran 12, Malaysia 3, Greece 3, Egypt, none. Iraq, none. Jordan, only one. Saudi Arabia, there are many scientists in Saudi Arabia, but they are originally not from the Saudis. They are come from Europe, America. So we need scientists from the inside our world. Israel 10, Pakistan only one scientist. So this list show that we there are around 3,000 high researchers in the wallet, and in the Arab wallet we are only have two. One from Jordan, that's me, and one from Algeria, and he's working in Saudi Arabia. So it is, the results are really, really disappointing. So let me start talking about my research story. This is my personal data. I am from Jordan, born in 1962. Married, I got my BSc from Yarmouk University in 1984, and I got my PhD in applied mathematics from the University of Wales in the United Kingdom. My PhD was in applied mathematics. It is about some problems in non-Newtonian fluid mechanics. Fluid mechanics, non-Newtonian fluid mechanics, it has two parts, theoretical part and experimental part. I used to do the theoretical part, then go to the laboratory and do the experimental part. I finished my PhD in 1991, and then I went back to Jordan. I started my career at Mu'ta University in Jordan. Mu'ta is a small town in the desert in the south of Jordan. There, I started 1991 to until 2009. But during that, I went to Yarmouk University for 1 year, from 2000 to until 2001. Then I went to United Arab Emirates University 3 years, from 2001 to 2004. I put it in a red color because there it has a great impact on my research experience. Then I went to Qatar University, back to Mu'ta, and from 2009, I moved to the University of Jordan, the capital of Jordan in Amman. So I went to 5 universities in 3 different Arab countries. There I met different faculty members. I conducted research with members from Mu'ta, from Yarmouk, from United Arab University, from Qatar, and from the United States. So it enriched my research experience. So I finished my PhD in 1991. In 1991, when I left to Jordan, I went to Mu'ta University. First, I tried to build a laboratory for non-Newtonian fluid mechanics. I stayed 2 years trying to build this laboratory, but I failed. No money, no financial, to cover the building of my laboratory. I need hundreds of thousands of Jordan dinars, and we do not have much this amount of money. So I left it, and I turned to the theoretical part. You see, non-Newtonian fluid mechanics, it is applied mathematics. We have very complicated equations. In order to solve these, I need high-speed computers. But there, I remember in 1991 or 93 to 90, we have Pentium 486, very old computer. I couldn't use it. I couldn't apply it. So I couldn't do the experimental part. When I moved to the theoretical part, I couldn't do it too. So I felt frustration. I felt disappointed. I couldn't do any research. In 1994, I tried to connect Malta University with the international network. So I wrote many letters to the president of university, of my university, and he phone called me and asked me, what's this international network? I thought of the following answer. I said, while you are sitting at your office, you can read from the American Congress Library. He said, it is impossible. I cannot believe you. I said, this is the truth. Later, in 1996, we connected Jordan. So I failed to connect Malta University with the international network. Then, in 1995, I met an Iraq scientist in Jordan, and he introduced to me a new calculus called the fractional calculus. This is very important calculus for the applied disciplines, for physicists, for engineers, for medicine, for chemistry, for all applied disciplines. From there, I started to work some problems in fractional calculus. So from 1991 until 1998, I tried to do the research. But in the 15th of March, I had, in my small apartment, I had a fire accident and everything, I lost everything. Because we have a heavy load, 18 credit hours, 6 sections to teach students, so I put anything related to search in my apartment and anything related to teaching in my office. So when I have this fire accident, I lost everything. So I didn't, in this 7 years, I didn't do any research. My goal was, is to do research for promotions. I only need to do 5 papers in order to promote to associate professor. That's all. That's my goal in that time. Well, in 1998, I started a second stage. I did a research for promotions. I remember, on the 1st of May, it was a holiday in Georgia. This is 1998. It was a holiday, and we have three days as a holiday, the 1st of May and Saturday and Friday. I said, okay, from now on, I will start to do research. And my goal was to promote associate professor, not anything else, not to do high quality research, just to publish in second or third class journals and to promote that. And in the November 29th, I really promoted to associate professor. But I like doing research. I started in the 1st of May doing some research, but later on I like doing research. Then, 2001, I moved to United Arab Emirates University. From there, I know about the electronic library. I know about the e-publishing. I know about the online submission. I know all about the new techniques for scientific research. And in 2000, I won the Tawaz Prize for Young Arab Scientists. That was my first prize. For me, it was a great impact because all my goal was to do research for promotion, not for winning any award. So this is the second step. I did research for promotions. 95 of the Arab scientists in the Arab universities are doing research for promotions only. They are not doing high quality research for the sake of research, only research for promotions. Well, I started in 2004, the second stage. 2004, I want to publish in high class journals, ISI journals with high impact factors. I started 2004. The problem I faced, I work in fractional calculus, it's a new science, and the second problem, I'm a scientist from Jordan, so when I sent my papers to first class journals, they rejected my papers. But later on, I succeed to publish some papers, These some papers get highly cited papers because all most of the scientists they used by methods and my papers. In 2006, I promoted professor, and in 2005, I established the first research group in fractional calculus in the Arab world. I will tell later on about this research group. Classical publishing. Classical publishing, if I need to choose a problem, I have to review the literature for this problem. Then I go to library, I try to search some hardcopy of journals, I stayed 3 months to review the one problem. So it was very tedious, tedious work to do that. Then if I need to solve this problem, we are talking about mathematics, I'm mathematicians, then I need highly speeded computers and it's not available in that time. Then if I need to submit a paper and send it by ordinary mail, then it takes 3 months to deliver it. Then after 6 months, I will get a message that my paper is under review. So it is, then I publish it in hard copy journals, which is, will be available for a small amount of, let's say, scientists. In 2001, I moved to e-publishing, electronic publishing. Now, if I am using the electronic library, instead of spending 3 months for reviewing only one problem, now I spend only 3 hours. I can know everything about the problems using the electronic library in 3 hours. Solving the problem, now we have high-speed computers everywhere, and we have new packages for writing, and then we use online submission. If you are using classical submissions, then we need 6 months to know that our paper is under review. But now using online submissions, I only need 5 seconds. That's all to know that my paper. Later on, when I publish my paper, it will be available so many people they can use it. So the number of citations will be great. Let me tell you now some of the important databases that any scientist should know about this. Thomson Reuters, I work of knowledge, suppose I work of science that evaluate the journals and give the impact factor. Scopus database, evaluate the scientist and give that index. ResearchGate, the ResearchGate is the same as this, but it's designed for scientists. So I advise anybody to have account in these databases. Google Scholar gives the H index and G index. Academia.edu, social networks like Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Science Direct is a database and it covers about 1 to 5% of the literature. It is really important database for people working in the scientific disciplines like engineers, like mathematics, chemistry, biology. So it is really important. And we have open research and computer. This is what we call it the identity number. Any scientist should have an identity number. If you have this identity number, then it gives you anything about your research, your work, and everything about you. So I encourage all the scientists to have account in these databases. So now, let me show you some of the honors that I got. I become RSI highly cited researcher for 2 years, 2004 and 2015. Then I went to, I joined the world's most influential scientific minds in 2014. Publishing, my goal, as I told, was to publish 5 papers in order to promote it to associate professor. But when I engage in scientific research and I feel the joy of scientific research, the pleasure of scientific research, I published more than 250 scientific papers in ISI journals. The H index is 49, citation 7,400. This is the highest in Jordan, at least in Jordan. And Scopus database, the H index is 38, the number of citations is 4,700. And this is the highest in Jordan. Maybe the highest in the Arab world, I don't know, but this is the highest in Jordan. And I classified as the top scientist in fractional calculus. Actually, now I am number three. But from 2009 to 2012 or 13, I was number one in the world. Later on, this 6 months ago, many Arab scientists tried to wish or to break the barrier between, the physical barrier between Arab scientists and Nobel Prize. Until now, no Arab scientist, I'm not talking about Nobel Prize in peace, I'm talking about the scientific prize in chemistry, in physics, in medicine, in economics. No Arab scientist won this prize from the inside the Arab world, but we have only Najib Mahfouz, he won it in literature only. But other Arab scientists like Ahmed Zweib, he won it from UNASTIS, he stayed 20 years, he moved to UNASTIS in 1967, and he won it in 1998. So none of the Arab scientists won this prize. So they said, we want to break this barrier. We want to nominate some scientists. By the way, it's not allowed for me to nominate myself. So other people should nominate me. So many Arab scientists tried to nominate me for this prize. And I received hundreds of messages from Arab scientists in France, in the United States of America, and Europe, nominating me and encouraging my nomination for this scientist, for this prize. As I said, the goal is to break the physiological barrier between Arab scientists and Nobel Prize. Maybe I win it, maybe not, but the most important thing is to break this barrier between us as Arab scientists and this Nobel Prize. And the encouragement from all the Arab world, and one of them, as I said, from even Nobel laureates, from, for example, Malala, she's Pakistani, she won the Nobel Prize in Peace, she stood with me and other scientists. Now, why I am a mathematician? Why the nomination in physics, in theoretical physics, and not in mathematics? You see, there is no Nobel Prize in mathematics. Why? Because Nobel, there's a story, I don't want to tell it because it's a long story, but he didn't like to put a Nobel Prize in mathematics. I am applying mathematics, so I'm working in theoretical physics. Theoretical physics is a part of applied mathematics, so they nominated me in theoretical physics. By the way, as mathematicians, more than 20 mathematicians won the Nobel Prize in physics. John Nash died 2 or 3 months ago. He's a mathematician, but he won the Nobel Prize in economics. So we won the Nobel Prize in physics and economics because our contribution goes to all these disciplines. And I got the encouragement of His Majesty King Abdullah II and King Rania Abdullah for this, and they supported me to win this prize. Whether I won it or not, what I'm going to do, and other, we want to break this physical barrier between us and this Nobel Prize, and we hope maybe me or anyone will win it from inside our world. Well, thank you very much.